Today's topic will be the battle with discouragement. We're going to be reading out of Psalms chapter 42, verses 1 through 5 for our scripture reading. It says this, "As a deer pants for the streams of water, O my soul pants after you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. Where can I go to meet God? My tears have been my food day and night, while men say to me all day long, where is your God? These things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I used to go with the multitude, leading the procession to the house of God, with shouts of joy and thanksgiving, living among the thirsting throng. Why are you downcast, O my soul? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God." The scripture is not silent when it comes to depression, despair, and also discouragement. You can read the book of Psalms, and there's several onesies that are written that talk about when King David and some other people that wrote it was going through some very, very tough times in their lives. Some great men of God also battled discouragement and depression throughout their lives. You have Moses, you have Elijah, you have Jonah, you have Paul. When Paul was going around planting all the churches, he went through a lot of things in his life, and there's no doubt from time to time that he got discouraged trying to do the Lord's work. We really don't know who wrote Psalms chapter 42. Some people say it's the sons of Korah. Some people attribute it to King David, but it's really up in the air who actually wrote this. But we know whoever did write it, they was in a very, very dark place at the time that they wrote this. So just a few short things that I want to share with everyone this morning is simply this. When you feel discouragement, when you feel despair, do this. It says, tell God that you want to be in his presence. Like I said, if you go on and read the rest of this, there's no doubt that the psalmist, he needed a touch from God during this very dark time in his life. Like I said, he was deeply discouraged, and he attributed to the first verse where it says, as a deer pants for the streams of water, oh, my soul pants after you, oh God. You know, he was, like I said, he was in a very dark place in his life, and that's what he attributed to. He was emotionally and spiritually dehydrated. He was emotionally and spiritually drained. You know, with all the things that are going on in this world today, there's a good chance as you're watching this video online this morning that you might be feeling the very same thing that this psalmist was feeling here. Maybe you feel emotionally drained, you feel spiritually drained, and you're just kind of wondering what's going to be taking place over the next few weeks and over the next few months of your life. So understand this, it's okay to feel like that. No matter how good of a Christian person you may be, there's going to be times where you're obviously going to feel like that. Basically, what his soul needed, he needed to be energized by the touch of God. He needed his hope, he needed his joy, and that was only found in Jesus Christ. And it's the same way that the psalmist felt this way. It's okay, as I said, it's okay for you to feel that way. And I want you to know this today, that your only hope to get through anything in life is going to be found in a relationship with Jesus Christ. Let him be the Lord of your life. Let him take control of your life. That you're still going to feel these emotions, absolutely. We're going to talk about that a little bit later on. But your only hope and your only way to get through the things that are going on in this world today and the things that are going to go on after we get through this mess that we're in will only be found in, your only hope is found in Jesus Christ. Number two, it says, tell God you feel alienated from his presence. For some reason, we don't know why, but the psalmist was far away from the temple of God, the place where God resided at this time. And we're all well aware of that the church doors have been closed now for a few weeks. And if you're like me, you're feeling a little bit of anxiety. You're feeling a little bit of anxiousness, wondering when we're going to be able to gather together as a congregation. But as I spoke a few weeks ago, the Bible tells us to submit to the authority of God, and the state government and the government's telling us, hey, this is best for our country and for our citizens. So that's what we are doing as a church, and so that's why we're bringing you this stuff online every Sunday. But as I said, I feel the same pain a little bit that this psalmist feels. I wish that these church doors are open. I wish that I could meet with my congregation like many other pastors around this community and around this nation. They're feeling the same thing that you're feeling. They're feeling the same thing that I'm feeling. And understand this, it's okay to feel like this. Because no matter how long that you've been a Christian, no matter how long you've had a relationship with Jesus Christ, there's going to be times of discouragement. There's going to be times of despair. There's going to be times of depression. That's just part of living in the sinful world that we live in. We know that started all the way back, all the way over in Genesis chapter 1 and 2 and 3. But the Old Covenant, God dwelt in one specific place. I want you to understand this today, that God does not dwell in this building. This is simply a building. If you were around Hartville over the last few weeks, there's been a lot of hail damage, and we had damage to our building. But this is still a building. But in the Old Covenant, as I said, God dwelt in one specific place, and that was in the tabernacle, in what we call the Holy of Holies. And the only person that was allowed to go into the presence of God, and this was only one time a year, was the high priest. And the high priest would go in one time a year, and they was so scared that he may have unconfessed sin in his life that they'd actually tie a rope around him just in case he got in the presence of God and God got mad at him, so that they could literally pull him out so no one had to go in there. But that priest went into the Holy of Holies and offered atonement, offered sacrifice for the sins of the people. I want you to know today that it's totally different than what it was back in the Old Testament. The New Covenant, God dwells with His people, and that is through the Holy Spirit. When Jesus Christ came to live on this earth and die for your and I's sins, He had 12 disciples, and them disciples followed Him around, learning more about Him. And there's several times throughout the Scripture that He told them that I'm going to leave, and I'm going to send you a Comforter. And obviously, disciples they couldn't figure out what Jesus was talking about. They were scared. They didn't want Him to leave because He had been by their side. He had talked to them. He had taught them throughout His ministry and throughout the time with Him. But now Jesus, when He died, you go over to the book of Acts, and the Bible tells us that He sent the Holy Spirit to come and to live within us and to dwell in us. And that Holy Spirit today is the one that can get us through the things that we're going on in life. It's the Holy Spirit that speaks to me, that tells me, hey, Jeff, everything's going to be okay. Hey, Jeff, the things that's going on in this world, it's normal because of the place that we, or because of things that are going on. Romans chapter 8, verse 9 tells us this. It says, but you are not in the flesh, but you're in the Spirit. If indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you, now if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. If you don't understand the things that are going on in this life, and you don't understand the things that you're going through, and you can't figure them out, the question I want to pose to you, do you have the Holy Spirit? Do you have Jesus Christ in your life? Have you accepted Him as your Lord and Savior? Because if you've never accepted Him as your Lord and Savior, you do not have the Holy Spirit in you. You do not have the same Spirit within me. That Spirit, as I said before earlier, tells me what I need to be doing. That Spirit guides my life. It guides my spiritual life. It guides my physical life. It tells me when I'm doing wrong. It tells me when I'm doing right. And if you don't have them things in your life, and you're having trouble going through, and you're having trouble figuring out what's going on, let me ask you, do you have the Holy Spirit? Do you have a relationship with Jesus Christ? But know this, even if you have the Holy Spirit guiding you, even though you had God in your life, you can still feel that disconnect from God. There's been things that happened over my life. I know there's been things that's happened over the course of your life where you felt disconnected from God. That's a normal feeling, but understand this, that it wasn't God that left. It was you that may have walked away. The Bible says that God will never leave you or forsake you, that He will stick to you closer than a friend. But it's okay to feel disconnected from God, especially in the times that we're in. Like I said, the church doors can't be open. Maybe you have lost a job. Maybe you're fighting some other battle with cancer or some other thing. But it's okay to feel disconnected from God, because it does happen no matter how long you've been a Christian, how long you've had a relationship with Jesus Christ. But I want to describe to you a few things that may make you feel disconnected from God. And the first thing is simply this, the sin in your life. If you have sin in your life and you have known sin in your life, that puts a barrier between you and God. And when a barrier is between you and God, you are going to feel a disconnect from Him, because God and sin cannot come together, cannot reign together in your life. So if you have known sin in your life, that's one big reason why you may feel a disconnect. Number two is the difficult circumstances that you may be facing. As I said, We're in unprecedented times. The church doors aren't open. People's losing jobs. The unemployment is probably going to be at an all-time high. The leaders and church leaders, the local, state government, federal leaders are facing things that they have never, ever faced before. And these are difficult times for everybody in this nation. And if we're not careful, we can let them difficult times override us and let us feel disconnected from God when they really don't have to. Another thing is our emotions. Our emotions can play tricks on us. If we're not careful, we let our emotions get from best of us, and we begin, to feel that disconnect from God, doubting God. There's not a person that's ever walked on the face of this earth that's never doubted God at some point in their life. As I said, you go through trials, you go through tribulations. I've been through a few in my life, and I have doubted the goodness of God before. And there's no doubt I will probably doubt the goodness of God again. I will doubt that He really loved me or loves me. I will probably doubt that He really cares for me. But you understand this, that's a lie from Satan. That's a lie from the depths of hell. God loves you. He loved you enough that He made you, and He wants a relationship with you. But there's still going to be times where we all, even the greatest preachers, the greatest pastors of their generation, doubted God at some point in their life. Another one is unanswered prayers. Maybe you've been praying to God every day for some kind of a miracle in your life. Maybe you've been praying for a family member, for someone that you love that's maybe has this awful disease that's going around. Maybe they have cancer. Maybe they have some kind of other medical condition, and you're wondering why God is not answering your prayer. First of all, like I said, you got to have a relationship with Him. And when you have that relationship with Him, and then God begins to work in your life, because we don't know what the will of God is for anybody. I know I certainly don't know what my will is for you that are watching this, and you don't know what the will of God is for my life. But we all feel like God sometimes doesn't hear us, but I promise you, He does hear you. God loves you, and God wants to answer your prayers. It may not be in your time, and it may not be the way that you thought it needed to be, but we know that God's will is always perfect for you and my life. Sometimes we have a lack of understanding or a lack of faith. As I said, that can kind of go along with doubting God. There's no doubt times in my life that I have had lack of faith. I didn't think that God was going to answer my prayer, and only come to find out that God answered it, just not the way that I thought it was going to be. He answered it in a totally different situation or totally different way than what I ever thought that it was going to be or how it was going to happen. But now I can look back in my life and I can see how God was working things out. I've often thought about this, and I hope you really listen out to what I'm fixing to say. With the church doors being closed, there's many people that many churches around this country and around this nation are just like me. They're standing up behind their pulpits or behind their lecterns, and they are preaching the Word of God, and they're putting out on different social media platforms, whether it be Facebook or YouTube or the other things that people use today. And the Word of God is not being stifled. Actually, I would say more and more that the Word of God is getting out to more and more people as more and more people look to people of faith and look for the church to try to find out answers in these difficult times. So if you think that the Word is being stifled just because the doors are closed, I would say that you're absolutely wrong. I would think that the Word is going out even more. Don't get me wrong, when we're able to meet again, these church doors will be open and we will continue our regular worship services. But for this time, we know we simply can't. But I like I said, I would argue that we are reaching more and more people every day. Another thing is simply this, is fear. Fear is running rampant in this country. You can turn on the news outlets, and there's not very many good news stories out there. Most of it's based around fear. And so that's another thing that can make you feel disconnected from the presence of God. And the last thing is simply this. It could be self-pity. You feel sorry for yourself. You feel sorry for the situation that you're in, and you think that God has put you in that situation that you're in. And folks, that's not always the case, because God always knows what's best for you, and God always wants what's best for you. To go on to kind of back to our passage of Scripture, the psalmist simply couldn't go to the house of God at this time. And these sufferings were being compounded each and every day because he couldn't change his situation. As I said, I can't change the situation here in the community that I live in. We know we have a few cases around, and a lot of businesses now are being shut down. The church's doors are closed for a period of time. And I've heard people say, well, you know, this is the government trying to do this, trying to shut down churches. I think if you go down that road, you're definitely going down the wrong road, because there's a lot of other things that are shut down and not operating other than the churches. But, you know, I can't change the situation. You can't change the situation with the world. But the only thing we can do as believers is to, be a part of the solution. And obviously not be a part of the problem. So, like I said, this psalmist couldn't change his situation. If I could have these doors open today, I would do that in a heartbeat. And so would many other pastors around this nation and around this community. But it simply can't happen here at this time. The psalmist had memories of better days when the temple doors were open. Like I said, we don't know exactly where he was at. We don't know why he couldn't get back to the temple to worship God. We don't know the things. It's not revealed to us here in this particular passage of Scripture. But he longed for better days. And, you know, I long for the days, as I said, the days where we can open up these doors, where I can see my congregation like many other people, and I can shake their hands and I can hug them, and I can spend time with them like I used to. But right now, I just simply can't do that. There's still other ways that you can connect with your church members, and obviously with people who don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. You can call on them, you can check on them, you can call their phones and just visit with them. And there's still ways to stay connected, even though these doors are wanted to be open. No doubt this psalmist, he longed to be, as I said, he longed to be worshiping God with his fellow people. As I said, I have that same longing that the psalmist did here at this time. But a question I want to ask you here this morning is simply this: have you taken for granted the church doors being open? And I think the answer to that is probably yes. I think a lot of Christians have taken for granted that the church doors are open, you know, on Sunday mornings and on Sunday nights and on Wednesday nights, and we can come in, and worship freely anytime that we wanted to. And I hope that this is a wake-up call to our church, to the people of my church. I hope this is a wake-up call to churches around this community, around this state, and around this nation, that we never, ever take for granted the privileges that we have. And the privilege that we have is that the doors can be open, because, as I've said this before, I think once the doors open here soon, I hope it'll be sooner than later, we're going to figure out where the church come out on this. Is people going to go back and they're going to go back to their same old routine of coming now and again, or coming when they want to? Are they going to dedicate themselves to God because they have missed out, these few weeks of doors closing? Has God put a hunger in them, maybe like he's never put in before? And I hope that you're watching this. I hope that God has put a hunger in you to want to spend more time with him, to want to know him better, to want to read his word for yourself, and to do all these things. But the last thing I want to talk about, no matter what you're facing, the discouragement, the despair, the thoughts that you have, is this. And if you've not listened to any else thing I've said, and maybe if you've turned me on and turned me off, is simply this: your hope has to be in God. He is your only hope. He has to be, as some of the other psalms, he has to be the rock in your salvation. He has to be your rock at this time. Because if you put your faith and your trust in other people, they're going to fail you. It's going to happen. If you put your faith and your trust in me, at some point, I'm going to fail you. If you put it in the other people of this congregation, other congregations around, they're going to fail you. But if you put your faith and your hope and your trust in God, the Bible tells me that he has never failed anybody. Because if he ever failed one person, then he would not be God. Then he would not be who he said he was. And that's the question I'm asking. Where is your hope today? If you're feeling discouraged, if you're feeling despair, if you're feeling depressed, folks, that's just natural emotions. And this psalmist here was trying to get a hold of them emotion. He was trying to make sure that he controlled his emotions, and his emotions didn't control him. Because if you let your emotions control you, you probably do things that you wish you wouldn't have done. You probably will say things that you wish you wouldn't have said. So you have to get control of your emotions, especially during this very unprecedented time that we live in. But like I said, your hope has to be in God, and let him take control of your life. And I hope and pray that if you don't have a relationship with him, that you will do that. If you watch this message today on Facebook or on YouTube, type us out a message. We would love to speak with you. We'd love to talk to you about anything that you're going on in your life. We would love to help you during this time any way that we can. So if you have a need, you have a concern, you have a prayer request, like I said, shoot us a message on one of our social media outlets, and we'll be more than happy to, I will be, or somebody in my congregation will be more than happy to speak with you about the things that are going on in your life, especially if you're feeling discouragement, especially if you're feeling depression. Let us help you. Let me or somebody else take you through the Word of God and tell you what the Word of God says, and hopefully, I know that it will make you, that it will make it better. One thing before we close, I hope that you mark your calendars next Sunday and you tune in at 10 a.m. at this very time. We're going to be in a special remote location for our Easter message. I can promise you, you do not want to miss this. It'll probably be something like you've never seen before. And so 10 a.m. next Sunday, and bring your friends, gather around your TV, your phone, your computer, and you and your family watch it as a family. Because obviously next week is Easter. We won't be able to gather, but we'll still be together in spirit. So God bless you. Thank you for watching this. Like I said, if anybody needs anything, please let us know, and we'll do all we can to try to help you. So I just want to dismiss with a word of prayer, and God bless you. Thank you, Lord, for this day that you've given us. And God, we thank you for all that you do. Lord, I pray, Lord, if somebody's watching this here this morning, God, and they're fighting, Lord, that discouragement, Lord, they're fighting the depression in their lives because, Lord, of extenuating circumstances, God, that around them, Lord, that I can't control, Lord, that we can't control, but Father, we know that you're in control of all things. Lord, I pray that, Lord, we would pick up your word for ourselves, Lord, that we would reach out to, Lord, someone around us, Father, and we would, Lord, lead them people in the way they need to go. God, most of all, we thank you for your love and your mercy. Father, we thank you for your grace, and God, we know that you're in control of all things. God, did once again, this did not catch you by surprise. Father, you know what's happening. God, we love you and we thank you. These things we ask in your name.